Welcome, skulking greenskins, to the fog-wreathed swamps of the mortal realms, because today we are talking about Gobsprakk, the mouth of Mork, vulture rider extraordinaire and all-around awesome-looking hero for the Kruleboyz, and a new character introduced in the Kruleboyz section of the latest Auric Warclans battle tome. Now, one thing I'd like to add right up top, if you like this video and you're interested in the faction, please consider using my affiliate link in the description down below. Noble Knight Games is a fantastic store here in the Midwest of the US. They have discounts on all Games Workshop products and ship out stuff like the next day. It's kind of crazy. I've ordered from them a few times before I became an affiliate. I love working with them, and it goes a long way to supporting my wife and I. Now, for those of you who are new to Age of Sigmar or this specific character, Gobsprakk is a powerful shaman of the Kruleboyz. In fact, he's the premier, I guess, spellcaster, wizard, and seer of the Auric Warclans. He has achieved the title, the Mouth of Mork, as a distinct contrast to Gordrak's title of the Fist of Gork, meaning there's Gork and Mork, they come together. Gorkamorka is the god of destruction, but they can also separate. And so Gordrak leans the way of Gork, which is fighty. And then Gobsprakk leans the way of Mork, which is cunning. Now, as a shaman in general, there are some baseline things to chat about. He has access to some incredible magic and magical abilities, notably terraforming and illusionary skills. I say terraforming in the sense that the Kruleboyz as a whole are able to carry their preferred environments of the swamps with them wherever they go. They take their home field advantage with them. When they settle in to hunt their enemy or kind of a new base of operations they want to make, the ground begins to warp and bow and water seeps up from the earth, and soon the battlefield, whether it used to be a lush forest or an inhospitable desert, will turn into a fetid swamp, making every step of their enemies an arduous chore, and perfect to be attacked when they are unprepared. There really is a heavy emphasis on changing the environment, right? The Kruleboyz are swamp-dwelling folk, but, you know, that means very little when you can take the swamp with them. They can kind of go wherever they want. As for the illusionary part that I mentioned, they can also call in, like, powerful fogs and miasmas to hide and mask the Kruleboyz in thick shadows, to poison the air of any defenders that they're hunting. And some of these miasmas are straight toxins, while others are hallucinogenics meant to destabilize their prey. There's some great stories of, like, you know, a small war band of Kruleboyz will go against a huge city or settlement or defense network, and they're just going to, instead of having an upfront fight, they release a whole bunch of hallucinogenics and let the whole thing cave apart before they ever attack. Like, that's the kind of thing that's going on here, and it's incredible. And the Kruleboyz Warclan shamans also have a pseudo-religious role. They're often turned to for wisdom and guidance, and they're kind of the ones who reveal the will of Gorkamorka to the rest of the Warclan. That being said, there's a lot more going on here than a basic shaman, because Gobsprakk sets himself apart in some pretty epic ways. In fact, he's the undisputed leader of the shamans, and when he dips into any Kruleboyz war clan, the Kruleboyz know that he's in command, otherwise they face a quick death. We'll talk about that more when we cover the Grinnin Blades, which is one of the sub-factions, but essentially, Gobsprakk just kind of shows up and their current warlord is like, well, guess I'm a number two then, and basically just instantly gives command, which is so cool. And so what I wanted to do is highlight a few of the things that really make Gobsprakk unique to me. First up, Gobsprakk is just a straight up wizard of legend. Like, while all shamans can change the environment, no one does it quite to the extent of Gobsprakk. Not only can he turn a desert into a swamp, but he can do so by making, like, choking waters burst from the lungs of his rivals and enemies, literally drowning his foes as he twists their home into a new nightmare. Most understand him to be the chosen of Gorkamorka, or Mork specifically, of course, because of the green, crackling waw energy that wreathes him at all times. Now, while all Aurochs need to build up waw energy, and the wizards can wield that energy as a weapon, that's generally what happens with the other war clans, it's not a power that's perpetual. It wanes between fights and excitement. So when a battle's happening, all the orcs get into a frenzy and the waw energy is pumping, and now their shamans can use it at their command. Not so with Gobsprakk. He has like his own built-in engine for it, a power that's just at his command at all times. In addition to that, he's also a talented prophet. Between mystic vision's importance coupled with his own personal intuition and cunning, he's been right about a ton of events that are highly, highly specific. Like, you might go to a normal shaman, and, you know, normal being, you know, a Kruleboyz shaman, and say, they might tell you, we should go to X place for a good fight. That's the kind of, like, insight and foresight that I guess you would probably expect from the other war clans or other shaman. But when you talk to Gobsprakk, he's like, we need to go to X place to fight Y army. Not only that, but if we hurry, we can ambush them at this specific spot along the way. And hey, if we poison the river, it'll hurt their crossing 2 days from now. Also, here are their names, social security numbers, birthdays, and high school performance records. Like, it's just crazy. And so I'll give you an example of that in action, but his ability to foresee things is quite amazing. Now, one thing that stands out is that none of those gifts, obviously except for the lightning, are tangible. You can't see them. But just looking at him, you know he has a lot going on. First off, that mount, chef's kiss, incredible. But more importantly are the totems that he carries with him. Now, Kruleboyz don't generally care for trinkets and things like that, but the shamans do because they recognize the power of a totem as a focus. And they'll carry items of significance with them to focus power and use it in their rituals and seeing abilities and that kind of stuff. So just to name a few, Gobsprakk is cruising around with the hand of a Lord of Change kept in this realm only by Gobsprak's sheer willpower. I mean, it should dissipate and go to the realm of chaos. It just won't. He has 7 sets of eyes from various seers, I'm sure, which are meant to aid in his ability of foresight. He has mushrooms from a renowned Gloomspite Git shaman, and the skull of a super predator named Da Big Rippa, which he killed by stomping it to death with a Foot of Mork spell. Which is just about the coolest collection of curiosities in the Mortal Realms, as I can imagine, although it does raise a very important question: is there a one-handed Lord of Change back in the Realm of Chaos who's just waiting for his hand to dissipate in the real world and come back to him? But without a doubt, no, the most notable thing about Gobsprakk is going to be his relationship to the newest god-tier character in Age of Sigmar, Kragnos, the living earthquake and ender of empires. In a grand vision from Gorka Morka, Gobsprakk foresaw a future where he and Kragnos led a path of destruction across the whole of the realms, right? The big wall that Gordrak has been wanting for so long. But to give you a sense of how detailed his ability of foresight was, having this vision, he didn't go to the prison where Kragnos was. He didn't go to Excelsius, which other people knew was where Kragnos was headed. He didn't even go to the Dreadfort, where Kragnos was thrown after the events of Broken Realms Kragnos. Instead, he went to this very isolated location that he knew somehow Kragnos would end up after all of that. Like, he just saw all those events ahead and then went to some, like, truck stop that he was just knew that he would stop for gas at, right? That's the equivalent of how crazy and weird, how much foresight he has. And he found that he was able to understand Kragnos's ancient language and somehow could speak it in return. Almost, I get the sense of like a biblical act of speaking in tongues where I don't know how I understand you and I don't know how I'm speaking to you in a way that you can understand me, but somehow through some form of miracle, this communication is happening. And there, the two of them talked. Gobsprakk shared his vision of the two of them working together to basically conquer everything, and in this, Kragnos saw an opportunity. Before this meeting, the orcs that were with him were really more of an entourage. He wasn't leading them, they just saw how big he was and how easily he found fights and were like, I like fighting, so they followed along. But now, with a translator, he could speak. He could plan, and he could lead. So this works both ways. Kragnos gets an army to lead. Gobsprakk ensures his dominance within the Auric world by tying himself to the living god and idol that they all want to follow. And Kragnos will sometimes go fight alongside other Warhammers, of course, but he's most often seen with Gobsprakk and the Grinnen Blades because they can understand him through Gobsprakk. And as I end all my videos, I want to talk about why is he so cool? And the thing is, when you read the short stories and Even like the little battle tome updates, like the little timeline stories that involve him, he just has this presence that when he's around, every other orc is instantly on the same page of, that's the guy in charge. I like that his mythos is very practical. It's not a tale like Gordrak. There's nothing wrong with Gordrak. I like that there's a difference between the two, where Gordrak has this origin of like, a meteor from Gork came down from the sky, and in the rubble there was Gordrak, right? It's like this very crazy mythos. But Gobsprak's not like that. He's an opportunist. He's been making smart moves over and over again, playing the long game rather than the easy one. And between that cunning and his visions from Gorka Morka, he has brought himself to being a real threat to the realms. And I can't help but wonder, because of the nature of the Kruleboyz, how sincere he is with Kragnos. It's not mentioned in his entry that he's has any interest in manipulating Kragnos, really, but we know from some Kruleboyz stories, specifically the Amber Keep Watch, I think it was called, the short story that came in the Dominion set, we know that the Kruleboyz sometimes think that they can use Kragnos to manipulate him as a weapon. They want to direct the ire of a god towards their enemies and use him like a tool. So my question is, how much of that is Gobsprakk doing? We don't have a good idea. If he's sincere in his vision, he might, you know, sort of be using Kragnos in that he's a part of the vision, but ultimately, he might just be really devoted to Gorka Morka and this is the path he saw. But ultimately, that's what's awesome about the Kruleboyz, right? They have these little mini games of intrigue at every turn. You're constantly questioning motivations, but at the same time, they all have to work together to achieve something, and this is a great example of that. So friends, let me know your thoughts on Gobsprakk, the Mouth of Mork, one of the coolest models Games Workshop's made in a long time. I would love to hear them. Leave in the comments down below, and if you could, smash that like button for me. It goes a long way to supporting the channel. And I look forward to seeing all of you in my next Age of Sigmar lore video. Happy wargaming.